I wanted to do a quick rig rundown on my newest kit. This is Ethyl. Ethyl is a Yamaha Tour custom kit made between April of 88 and February of 99. And it is a five piece. The snare drum is different. I'll show you that in a little while. But these are alternating plies of birch and mahogany with birch on the inner and outer plies. Now the bass drum you'll see is in the wrong place. Well, it's in a different place. The bass drum with the Cragar Mag logo that's really representative of the era of classic rock the band I'm in plays. So that's why I did that. And anybody who filled a tank of gas before 1986 knows that Ethyl is 100 octane leaded gas. So the bass drum is over here all by itself. It's driven by a remote bass drum pedal, which I kind of rigged together out of a Tama double pedal. I've got a Pearl slave, main driving footboard on the other side. I like the Pearl footboard better, but found a good deal on the Tama pedal. So that's over here resonating by itself. And the toms, as you can see, are all together. No gap between the 13-inch tom and that first floor tom. In fact, the floor toms are moved way up, which is one advantage of doing this. Now, from a hardware perspective, I'm just using a single rack piece and a single stand over there. Now, this rack piece is pretty loaded. I'm using Pearl hardware for the arms. I like it better than I do Yamaha. And there are rims mounts, the old school rims mounts that were with these drums that I'm reusing. Got my center hi-hat here, and we'll show you that from the driver's seat too. But it's a Pearl Redline remote hi-hat stand. I have to reroute that cable because I know a guitarist is going to trip over that, so I'm going to route it a little bit tighter. But yeah, it's absolutely loaded up, this little rig. I've got, you know, my cymbals coming out of it, two 16-inch crashes coming out of the corners of this. Got a Pang coming out of this arm, which I can move pretty much anywhere. And then I've got some little cymbal extension arms coming off of there for my two splashes, my 14-inch crash. But I've got extra memory locks to hold the extra weight of everything here. I want to make things portable and repeatable. So you can see that's just a stand holding two cymbals and a cowbell over there. Pretty simple. And on the rug, you can probably see some industrial Velcro on there. It's white industrial Velcro that I use to mark the feet where everything goes, so that when I get to a gig and figure out where I'm setting up, I roll out the carpet and just start setting things where they go. And it's a snap. It makes things so much faster. But I've just got to burnish these down. I use a skateboard wheel to burnish them down, and then I've got to vacuum up the cat hair before I go tomorrow. So here's that snare drum. This is a Tour custom maple, 5.5 by 14. It's got two snare strainers on it, which is different, but kind of growing on me. Now you can see these toms are almost flat with that snare drum. I've got them up a little bit because I use an Electro Voice PL35 mic, and it's got a nice angle, and those kind of protect that microphone a little bit. So here's a view of the center hi-hat and my playing angle. Again, the beauty of moving that bass drum up is these floor toms, the 16-inch floor tom is forward of my snare drum. And that 18 isn't even 90 degrees over to the right here when I sit down to play. Normally an 18 is going to be over here. You got a twist, and normally you've got toms up in the air on the bass drum. And from a resonance perspective, I don't like that. And also, you have to reach way up and tilt the toms way back. But here, this is a nice fluid playing environment here. Everything is within easy reach It's a new placement for a ride cymbal. I normally have it more to the front, but I kind of dig this over here, and I can, again, it's isolated. It's on its own. I got everything has space here, and really easy to play. But yeah, just having this pedal here, it's like a double pedal, but it's a remote. Now inside that drum, I have a microphone. I took the tom mount off of it. Again, I'm not using hardware on top of it. The hole is the perfect size for an XLR jack. So I've got a Shure Beta 91A boundary mic suspended on a Kelly Shoe Flats mount. And I'm probably going to be pulling that out this afternoon. I've got another Kelly shoe mount that I'm going to be putting a Sennheiser E902 inside of this. But again, there's the view of this. View from over here. Just a simple stand. I leave most of that together. And not much to transport. I got a van, and I've got hard cases for the 18-inch floor tom and the bass drum. The rest are soft cases. I've got the nice case for the snare, the Ahead armor cases. I've got those for two snares. My backup snare for this is a Pearl Prestige Session Select 5.5-inch birch snare, which is just beautiful. I've got them tuned. They almost sound identical. Hard to tell which one's birch and maple if you have your eyes closed and don't see me hitting them. But they sound great. They're going to crack through with the rest of these toms. These toms are very expressive, to say the least. I had clear emperors on them, which was kind of a mistake. I did a drum cover of Montrose's Rock Candy, so you can hear how just ridiculous they are. I don't like the clear emperors. They don't have as much definition as what I have on here now. I put on a new set of Evans UV2 coated heads, and these are the bomb. I have these on my MHX mahogany kit, and just wonderful. Just wonderful. They stay in tune well. They tune up easy, and they really control, kind of focus the drum, control some of that sustain, so it's just not completely wide open there. They're pretty tame, and I still have to kind of, you know, rein them in a little bit. Now, my other kits, my Pearl kits that I've had, I will link my rig rundown for my MHX mahogany kit above. And on that, I had the bass drum to the left, and I had a bunch of smaller toms, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16. I had an 18-inch bass drum I used as a gong drum for a while, and a couple of Pearl Rocket toms over there. But I could fit a large kit on a small footprint. I fit that kit, a 10-piece kit, within a 5.5 by 7.5 foot footprint. So just it tightens everything up. So I had all those toms just wrapped around me. You'll see it if you click on that video. And all the toms, you know, went flat over that smaller bass drum. But now that I've got a big bass drum and deeper toms, the only way I'm going to get that that flat ergonomic environment is by moving the bass drum. So I don't play a lot of doubles. I'm not a double bass player. I never, you know, really developed the balance for doing that. So I've got a pretty good right foot. I do literal heel to toe, where my heel strikes the footboard and my toe also. So I'm not doing heel to toe the right way, I suppose. I'm doing it some weird old way, but that's fine. And again, for repeatability, I've got everything. I do things my way, like Sinatra. But I've got everything's labeled, you know, Pang symbol. So when I pull that arm out, and stow it in my bag, I can pull it out, put it right back together. 16-inch B, 16-inch B, all of these 16A, 16A. So everything is marked. The 14 is marked. The splashes are marked. So I know where everything goes, and the toms I really don't need to mark. But I do use a magic marker. I know other people do this too, but to mark symbol angles, because I like to break these down when I put them back up. I like to see how far that arm comes out and what angle. So I've got like three lines on there that I line up. Same with right here. See three lines on there. Then I've got, you know, the mark that shows basically this is where it stops. So every time I reconfigure a kit, I have to get out some alcohol, like you can see some old ones here, and kind of clean off the old mark so I don't get confused. Again, there it is on that symbol. I've got it up on that one too, so I can collapse these, reopen them, and just, again, in a snap, just set this drum kit up. But I love the kit. I'm going to play it out for the first time tomorrow, July 2nd, for a private community in Illinois. And should be a blast. Should be a gas. But give it a shot sometime, you know. Try an unconventional setup. Get the bass drum somewhere else so that you can get all those toms together, man. You'll have a new relationship with your drum kit and a new way of seeing the world. Now, I know folks have tried the center hi-hat, and they've got a problem with, you know, reaching it. And I have to admit, you know, if I pull that further forward, it's going to get in the way of, you know, playing those toms. So I wanted to keep that comfortable. It's up not too much higher when I play. I mean, it's from snare. I just have to have good posture. If I don't have good posture, I'm going to be hitting down here and slopping up and, you know, hitting my snare mic and stuff. So I really have to have good posture, but you should have good posture when you're playing your drums. You should always have good posture. Ask Phil Collins about that. But I've got these little splashes. It's a little Oriental Zildjian trash splash. And then I've got a China trash here. And you'll see all those symbols. And these are Zildjian Rezos, regular Zildjian A Custom 14. 16-inch Rezo. This is a regular medium thin crash 16. 14-inch Rezo hi-hats. 16-inch Rezo pang. 21-inch Rezo ride. And an 18-inch Rezo crash. I love the cymbals. And you can hear those on my videos. So I'm not just going to go banging on them now, because the microphone on my phone really sucks for sound reproduction. But it's a nice comfy kit. I mean, I can just sit down and play this. Just, I had to, you know, change my intervals and tunings for these drums, you know, 12, 13, 16, 18. I normally don't play an 18-inch floor tom, but I couldn't resist. We play a lot of classic rock, combination of these drums and these heads. Great for like Boston and Heart. And anything, basically anything else we're playing, Fog Hat, they just sound incredible. So something you're gonna have to, you know, reimagine, like when we play Hotel California, you know, I gotta bring the rocket toms in for the timbali parts. I'm probably gonna mount those over here on an arm. Got some cool little clip-on mics for those. And if I run out of channels on our soundboard, I always have a submixer, a little Carvin submixer that I use for the toms, and let the sound man have the bass and snare all to themselves. But let me know if you have any questions. I'm sure you're going to have comments and opinions, but this is how I do it. So this is how I'm doing it, at least with this set of drums. So it's unusual. It's a freak show, and it's me. But please like, comment, share, and subscribe if you haven't already. Thank you.